as an American, I see myself as a black man. I don't know if I can go as far as saying I'm American.
Sure, I see myself as American. I couldn't be nothing else but American. I'm born in America.
Because I was born in America.
I see myself as a black American.
I see myself as black.
Blacks all around the world see themselves as black. The problem of identity really differs in degrees from country to country. Yeah.
I'm, you know, part black, part Dominican, you know. And my father, you know, he came from Spain. Yeah. So, you know, I'm all part of everybody, I think.
My culture is Puerto Rican. My race is black. And the society in which I live in, the society in which I've grown up in, is the American society.
Is no less bitter than it was before the Civil War. During Reconstruction, or since the dim hope provided by the 1964 Civil Rights Act. In reality, the problem of color is the enormous problem of how to resolve the positive as well as the negative impacts that occur when different cultures come together, blend, interact, struggle for dominance, and occasionally explode. We call this process interface. Interface. An interface is the place where independent systems meet and act upon or communicate with each other. Interface. We believe that people are the most perfect of systems, and it is people, people in all the societies of America, that interface is concerned with. America has been called a society that has lost its identity, a country that is losing its mainstream of common values. For most Americans, the choosing of a lifestyle is energized and motivated by a variety of desires. One needs a closeness to the land. Another is spurred on by accomplishments in the arts, the sciences. For some, money is the key, and that governs their relationships, their needs, their yearnings. All of these can be seen as the root causes of interfacial relationships. In most of the Western world, our lifestyles and our yearnings are sold to us through the media. These yearnings, these needs, are sold to us when we choose our clothes, our friends, sometimes even our religious beliefs or our ethics. Now, let's consider the question of lifestyles for a minute. A man in Connecticut, a Connecticut Yankee, might believe that he is the American gentleman. If he believes that about himself, then his choices have to be consistent with that belief, and he has to live a style of life that reinforces that belief, even though that belief may be comprised of little understood psychological needs. A man in Waco, Texas, a cowboy, probably has another problem. He has to convince himself and other people that even though he is poor, he is free and tough and independent. A Texas cowboy and a Connecticut Yankee might be expected to have some things in common. They would probably be white, and they would probably be American. But if they were brought together, they probably wouldn't see eye to eye on most things because each would feel that his lifestyle was being challenged by the other. They would reject each other for disturbing their concepts of the world.
Hush, you boy, don't you cry. Go to sleep a little baby. When you wake, you shall have all the pretty little horses, blacks and bay, dapple and gray, coach and six of little horses, blacks and bay, dapple and gray, coach and six of little horses.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. We'd like to welcome you at this time to the second of five performances of the first annual New Haven World Championship Rodeo. First, you'll be watching activity here that has its roots deeply embedded in America's history, just as you have in this historic New England area. Rodeo grew up on the front.
The images and myths of the American West have been preserved, not as history, not as fact, but rather as children's fables and fairy tales. We see a rodeo. Those who participate, those who come to watch, see parts of an American dream. There are 600 rodeos exhibited each year in the United States. Rodeo appears to be a sport, but really it is a business, manufacturing tradition.
And Eastern rodeo athletes. For rodeo is a sport, it's demanding, competitive, and highly individualistic, where the best athletes will prevail regardless of what their backgrounds might be. So today we will dedicate this performance to our country and to the individualism that has made it great. Okay, now everybody hold on to your eardrums. Cover your ears. We don't want to have any punctured eardrums.
This was the first rodeo to be performed in New Haven, Connecticut. Most New Englanders in the audience had been given free tickets. They had come reluctantly, expecting to be displeased. In New England, a cowboy is socially suspect. A cowboy is someone who has much to learn about the finer points of living. He is not to be encouraged in any way. The promoters were hoping to break down New Haven's lack of interest in rodeo. They appealed to a sense of national solidarity and ignored regional differences between New England and the American Southwest. The odds were against the cowboys.
New Englanders are hard sell. They're really going to look at something before they're going to go and participate. I think you're dealing with people who just don't change easy. And they're used to seeing circuses and ice follies or ice capades, parades too. But they have never had a rodeo here. I just don't think they were ready to, you know, come running to it because it was here. You go upstate, when they say New England, they think of colonial heritage.
Well, it's an identity group, I guess. It's like anything else. The longer you stay around something, you will automatically pick it up.
Cowboy is the guy who was probably born on a ranch or in proximity to a ranch, and that was his way of life. To him, he doesn't look at it as a culture. That's all he knows. Whereas a black cowboy or a Jewish cowboy, which you notice they don't have, or an Italian cowboy, he is probably somebody who transplanted himself, either for, you know, for one reason or another. He moved out west because he liked it or because circumstances forced him to.
This is Bud Graham now, president of the Black Cowboys Association, the Black Rodeo Cowboys Association. So watch out for a good run here. He needs 12 miles.
Bud Bramwell was born in Connecticut and left New Haven when he was 17 to join a rodeo.
Somebody says they know me, they don't say they don't know me because I'm black, they know me because I can rope. I just love the rope. Yeah. To me, it's relaxing. I just love the rope. You can put on a cowboy hat, I don't care if it's in Harlem or on Fifth Avenue. People want to meet a cowboy. I don't care if it's white or black, it's like an American heritage thing, you know. It's, everybody likes a cowboy. And you talk to the kid, oh yeah, every little kid wants a horse, right?
Now he is a professional cowboy, living a dream. Bud Bramwell believes in the rituals of rodeo.
Most of these guys are rodeo men, they'd rather rodeo than do anything. It's a good, clean sport, you know, and you're betting your own ability against an animal or another man. People that aren't rodeo oriented, they don't realize that a guy's been learning how to do that for 25 years, so he can do it. You put an ad in the paper, rodeo, New Haven Coliseum, big deal. What's rodeo? People back here in the East are really a son of a bitches. Most of the people from Connecticut are, you know, they're not satisfied with what they've done with their lives or with the trap they've gotten themselves into, you know. They have a job, make $300-$400 a week, $200-$300 a week, you know, $15,000 a year. That's all they want. I met a guy in a doctor's office a couple of months ago. He's a drug salesman. And he says, oh, geez, all my life I've wanted to just get up and go do something. You know, he wanted, I don't know, the sailboating or racing or something. But, you know, I got a wife and a kid, and I'm a scared. You know, shoot, somebody, you know, everybody in the world, they want to do something, but they're scared. Mm-hmm. These cowboys, they want a rope, and that's it. Because people just get in a rut. They'll get them a job, being a 9-to-5-er, you know, and they get in a rut. Like a man can do anything he sets his mind to do. It's not a judge's thing, you know. You're out there competing against the clock, you know. If you can afford to pay the entry fees and you can go out there and do it, anybody, they don't care what color you are. It's just strictly interested in, can you do it, that's all. If you can't do it, you're not going to be in it, you know. My wife is white, so, that, you know, I'm not interested in getting in a black bag or anything, you know. Nobody owes you anything. People think because their grandparents were slaves on the farm that now the government owes them a living. It's an unfortunate situation. We were in slavery, but hell, you got to get out here and make it now, you know.
He doesn't believe he is different from any other cowboy. Bramwell hasn't noticed that he is alone. He hasn't noticed that there is silence around him.
To be black and going for a cause, it doesn't interest me a bit. I've got no hang-ups.
Black people have a saying, every brother ain't a brother. This homily comes from understanding that a man's social identity and interests are not necessarily dictated by the color of his skin. A man like Bud Bramwell may be colored black, but if he sees himself as a cowboy and doesn't relate to anything outside the world of cowboys, then he is a cowboy. To call him a black cowboy may be to impose a set of values upon him that he may not share. There's a distinction between culture and race. Culture refers to a man's lifestyle, his values and beliefs, the sum total of a man's knowledge. In America, race means only color. A society that is preoccupied with race often confuses color with culture, but sometimes just the freedom to descend into the very essence of color provides the point from which a life of full development may spring. Such may be the life of Chick Moody.
To empathize with someone is to have the ability to put yourself in their place and understand their suffering. And the best way to do that is to have suffered yourself. And if you have suffered yourself, then you don't identify, you understand. Or maybe you do identify, who knows?
This is Chick Moody. He was born in Texas and is 50 years old now. Life hasn't been easy on Chick, but more than anything, life has made Chick a natural man.
I'm not ashamed to get welfare because, for one thing, I'm a product of the state. The state produced me in a if you evaluate it logically, the fact that I was placed in an orphanage before I was six, I was transferred to a reformatory before I was 10. I got out when I was 13, went back when I was 13, got out when I was 16, went back when I was 16, got out when I was 19, went to the penitentiary when I was 20, didn't get out until I was almost 28, went back before I was 30, etc., then welfare is just a logical continuum of my lifestyle. And the only time I have been paid for any of this was for a period of 8 or 9 months when I worked in the jute mill in San Quentin. I made a big $7 a month. So I consider it to be salary or back wages that it owes, that is owed me, plus the fact that for all intents and purposes, I myself really do not get welfare. It's basically supplementary to the job I have here as superintendent, mostly for my wife and children. I identify with my wife because she is my wife and the mother of my children. My wife is black, then I don't want anyone trying to run any games on her because she's black. I don't want to hear no nonsense about mulattoes because they're not mules, which mulatto means. I don't want to hear about no high yellows and any nonsense like that. Or I would say I'm an isolationist, because I have found that most people, when they say integrationist, what they really mean is to absorb, not, in other words, to bleach out. You have to penetrate past the external into the person, and that determines really why, what they think. They identify as a white man of the nature of John Brown. I do not identify as a white man in the typical, quote, white, unquote, bag, in that I do not believe in white supremacy. I do not believe in any form of racial, ethnic, superiority. I think of white and black as a state of mind. I recognize that there is a social structure in this country, a class structure, and then part of the divisive tactics is divide by color, as well as your ethnic origin, as well as your height, as well as the way you dress, the color of your hair, the texture of your hair, the whole bag, you know. I have empathy with people who have suffered and been oppressed and depressed and everything else. There's a lot of change that has to come about in the world. I do not think it can be done peacefully. On the other hand, I don't think it can be done by committing suicide. On the other hand, I don't think it can be done by being submissive and passive.
And you should be in this position.
I think that an honorable death is preferable to a dishonorable life.
In the span of time that I've known Mr. Moody, I believe it's approaching the third year, that he has been a diligent and sincere and dedicated practitioner to all of the aspects of Budo, which means a martial arts way, and has adhered to the philosophies. And therefore, Bushido is the main ingredient of these philosophies, and Mr. Moody has adapted to and practices these philosophies on a daily basis.
I don't have the type of arrogance or anything to try to dictate to others what they should do. I have my own beliefs and my own values, some of which that may change. They do change because not to change eliminates growth. You cannot be set in your ways. If you don't grow, you stagnate. And if you stagnate, then that is a form of suicide. To go out and contest someone with a gun when you have no gun is suicide. Unless you learn how to do it in such a way that that gun becomes absolutely useless. You must commit ethnic suicide in this society in order to fit into a WASP society. And the further away you get away from blonde, blue-eyed, white, Protestant thought, attitude, dress, lifestyle, and everything, bam, the further you get away from success. I view this society, as well as all of the Western societies that I am familiar with, as a slave master society, a slave master relationship. As people came to this country from Europe, they would attain a certain degree of economic stability, etc. As the next group came over, instead of saying, well, look, you know, like we came here from a foreign country, we came here because we were deprived, we came here because we were oppressed, we came here because we couldn't get legal rights, we couldn't get social rights, we couldn't get civil rights, so we came here to get them. Now we have acquired them. You are coming for the same reason. We'll try to make it easier on you and help you. No, this is not what happened. They push them down and try to push them down further and use them as a stepping stone to step higher. And then as each new group came, this process was completed. It's very divisive.
By raising our children as warriors, I believe that this war out here, you know, in the neighborhoods, living is a battle, and that they have to be prepared for whatever comes up. They have to be prepared for choosing the right, if they're going to get married, choosing the right mate, so that people don't take advantage of them. Preparatory for life. That's what life is.
Say hello.
Struggle.
initially, I got involved in it as a means of self-protection. There again, that's an ongoing thing because when I was in prison, I boxed. When I got too old to box, I trained and taught other people. Now that I've gotten into it, I have discovered that it entails tremendous discipline and enables you to broaden your scope and grow, and it also enables you to learn that you have to be able to fight on all levels, the highest level being intuitive intellectual combat, the lowest level being able to get down on the ground and rumble there, and that you have to do this in order to really attain your true identity, and that this way you grow and you reach a lot of spiritual levels. At least I have reached spiritual levels that I previously had not reached. But at the same time, I am learning each time I go to the dojo and work that by going back to the mat and getting down on the mat, I do not lose my foundation. I go back to my roots. And I think that the most important thing that any society produces is the people. And if they mass produce psychological cripples, then that means there's definitely something wrong with the society. If they mass produce the ugly American, then there's something wrong with that society.
Stand up.
People are the main product of any country. And the way they conduct themselves, the way they believe, the way they actually think and act is the most important thing. Truth lies in subjectivity. That information goes in an individual, it is subjective. It spins around inside of them, but when it comes out objective. Because once you get inside yourself and really understand it, the more you understand about yourself, the more you understand about other people. I believe in that I'm a yea-sayer, where, you know, in the philosophical aspect of philosophy, you have yea-sayers and naysayers. I'd like to think of myself as a yea-sayer, that misery will end. Not too soon, but eventually.
Bud Bramwell and Chick Moody. Two men drawn from the same mold? Hardly. One seems to be on the way to self-realization. The other has no hang-ups. The resolution of the positive as well as the negative impacts that occur when different cultures come together, blend, interact, struggle for dominance, and occasionally explode. This is Interface. I'm Tony Batten.
Learn from black people in the country?
Yeah.
Well, I guess the major influence has been in music.
You know, it's very difficult. I never thought about it before.
Well, it's quite a few things. It's hard for me to say just what.
I don't know, man. I mean, dancing, that's one thing, right?
Dancing, right.
Well, there's a lot of things I've learned from black people in this country. No different than I am.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.